We're going to start Section 7-2. The 7-1 worksheet, thank you very much. I've got half of it done in video. I've got the top half with like the proportions, which incorporate quite a bit of factoring. I've got those in a video. I'm going to send that out once I get it posted to YouTube after school. And then I will get the second half of that completed as well, and I'll get that out to you in a second video so that you can see how to address those correctly if you struggled on that worksheet. But basically 7-1, what it was doing was laying the foundation for the algebra that we're going to use pretty much for the rest of the year. It's not going to be the only thing we use, but it's going to be used quite a bit, using proportions, using factors, that kind of thing, being able to cross-multiply. And that becomes very useful for other courses as well. You guys on your calculators have sine, cosine, and tangent on your calculators, right? S-I-N-C-O-S-T-A-N. Those are developed and true based off of the similarity and proportion stuff that we're going to be talking about in the next couple of days. And it's going to kind of allow us to make the bridge from what we talk about now to using sine, cosine, and tangent. And I think if you understand where those values come from, so for instance, when I type in sine of 30 on my calculator, no matter how many times I do it, it's going to spit back 0.5 to me. Okay, where does that come from? That's kind of the idea of similarity. If we understand similarity, that's where it comes from. And if you understand that, seeing those numbers, like when I type in, sine of 60, it gives me it gives back 0.866 or something like that. Where does that number come from? Why does it give me that number? It's because of similarity. And if we can understand that, it makes the process of using sine, cosine, and tangent later on so much easier. Okay. Instead of just kind of blindly saying, well, this is what I'm supposed to, these are the steps, you can kind of understand why those are the steps. And it makes the algebra a little bit easier for you to do. So that was Section 7-1, laying the foundation for that stuff. Today we're going to actually start using it, and we're talking about similar polygons. Okay. The branches of geometry that we've talked about are the main concepts in geometry were congruency, incongruency, so not being congruent. When we talk about that, we usually talk about the hinge theorem, the side-side-side inequality theorem, that kind of stuff. And then this section or cluster of ideas in regards to similarity. Okay, similarity is all about on the, of course, exam. It's often asked about in the ACT. It's a very, very important concept. My trig students, okay, they started the trigonometry course about 2 weeks ago, and that's basically all we've been talking about since they started was similarity and using proportions to allow us to solve some authentic trigonometric problems. So the idea here is that you're going to use that here in this course, and it's a concept that gets overlaid into other courses quite a bit. Okay, very, very useful. When we talk about congruency we defined it as same shape, same size. Same shape, same size. We talk about similarity, okay, to define similar polygons. It's the same shape again. Okay, so only two polygons can only be similar. Triangles, or if they're both quadrilaterals, or if they're both hexagons, a triangle will never be similar to a hexagon. Does that make sense? Okay. And what's going to force those to be the same shape is the number of vertices they have. And what we want about those vertices and those angles that are created those vertices is that those corresponding angles have to be congruent. And that's going to provide us the same shape that we're interested in. Okay. The second part that dictates kind of the different size. The different size is dictated by side lengths, okay? And you see there in that second condition, it says corresponding sides are in proportion. Corresponding sides are in proportion. So when we have similarity, there are two conclusions to it. Two conclusions. One is that all corresponding angles are congruent. The second one is that all corresponding sides are in proportion, meaning if I look at one set of corresponding sides, then I need to get that same 2-to-1 ratio in all sets of corresponding sides. Okay, and we'll see that here in this example. The reverse of that, or the converse of that, okay? So this is saying if I have similar polygons, these two conditions need to be met or are met, okay? The converse of it is if I can look at two shapes and know that the corresponding angles are congruent, and I can determine that corresponding sides are in proportion, that shows that I have similarities. That makes sense? So it's a two-way street, okay? If I look at that picture down there at the bottom, a lot of these examples that we're going to see, the pictures are, you're going to hear me say, they're in the same orientation as one another. I mean, it just looks like that one of them has been cut, slid over, and then pasted back down, okay? Now, they're going to change size, okay? One might be bigger, one might be smaller. But they're not rotated, they're not reflected or anything like that. Does that make sense? All right. So I'm just going to go through a couple examples here real quick to show you that idea. All of these, like, you know, this one here, if I just slide it over, slap it down, all these parts are going to match up when I slide it through here. Does that make sense? Okay. Same thing here. Same thing with that one. Same thing with that one. And the reason they're this way, it was just the easier thing to do when I made the PowerPoint and kind of cut these out from other textbooks. What I need you to understand is that they might be like that. Even though we might see a bunch of these where it's just kind of an easy slide left or right, up or down to get the other image, here they're rotated or maybe even flipped. Does that make sense? Okay. We should be able, by going through the process that I'm going to teach you, be able to address any situation. Okay. If we can do that one, that's the hardest, then you can do all of them. All right. Is that all right, everybody? This flipping process and rotating is a pain in the butt to deal with if we don't understand the way we have to name these polygons, okay? If I look at this, okay, let's look at AD. Let's look at the angles first. Let's look at angle A. Would you guys agree that angle A, if I took that shape and slid it on top of angle E, angle A and angle E are going to match up 100%. Okay, so those are congruent angles. That's one set of corresponding angles that are congruent. I then need to justify that that's going to happen with D and H. It's going to happen with C and G. And it's going to happen with B and F, right? Does that make sense, everybody? Okay, those are corresponding angles, and they're all congruent. So that's that first bullet up there that says corresponding angles are congruent. That's usually pretty easy for us to recognize when we're trying to address similarity. The second sides are in proportion. Okay. Now, when I say corresponding sides are in proportion, because these two figures are in the same orientation as one another, they have not been flipped or reflected or rotated or anything like that, I can say like top compared to top, left compared to left, bottom compared to bottom, right compared to right. Does that make sense? I cannot do that. I cannot look at, where'd it go? These two and say top compared to top, bottom compared to bottom, right compared to right. Does that make sense? Because if I look at top compared to top, like AB compared to 4.5 radical 3, well, that's a hypotenuse, which it should be the longest side of the figure, right? Compared to 4.5 radical 3, which is not a hypotenuse, so it's not the longest side of the figure. Does that make sense? Okay. When we're doing these comparisons of similarity, if I'm comparing, you know, let's say I look at AD being 10, if 10 is the largest dimension in that figure on the left, then when I compare it on the figure on the right, the 5, that 5 better be the largest dimension in that figure. Does that make sense, everybody? So largest needs to be compared to largest, smallest to smallest, middle to middle, and so forth. Okay? So that's very important. So when I say top to top, bottom to bottom, left to left, right to right, I'm only doing that because I know that those shapes are in the same orientation. If they're rotated or reflected, I will do something different, and I'll address that here in a moment. But if I do that, if I just look at 10 compared to 5, what's 10 compared to 5? 2-to-1, okay? So I'm just going to write these out as 10 over 5 first. So 10 compared to 5, what's 8 going to compare to? 8 to 4. What's 6 going to compare to? 3. 5 is going to go to 2.5. Okay. Now, if these two shapes are similar, those ratios should all be equal. And that when we have ratios that are equal, that's meeting the definition of a proportion. A proportion is an equation that states two ratios are equal. Okay? Meaning that if I reduce those or put them all in the same format, whether I put them, maybe you like to put them in decimals and see that all the decimals are the same. I like to reduce them. Leave them as fractions. I like to reduce them. What's 10 divided by 5? 2. What's 8 divided by 4? 2. What's 6 divided by 3? 2. What's 5 divided by
Thank you.